Rusty Wallace devoted 25 years of his life to driving in NASCAR's top series. He found victory lane 55 times and captured the championship in 1989.
The Winston has been won by Rusty Wallace.
And he did it all driving for one owner, Roger Penske. Rusty has a lot to say, a lot of stories to tell, from comparing himself on track to Dale Earnhardt and then vacationing with him, to working on his own cars and then becoming a race broadcaster. Rusty discusses it all and more now. To welcome in the legend, my former colleague, Mr. Rusty Wallace. Rusty, it's great to see you.
Oh, thank you very much. It's great talking to you again. It's been a while, but hey, under these conditions, and we're doing this through this video, we're at least I get to say hello to you again.
I know, right? It's funny how many years we spent working together, and now we're both still in the sport, but we don't see each other so often. So what have you been up to over these last couple of months and not having racing in your life and not having broadcasting in your life?
Yeah, I tell you, I've learned to be a really good cook. I mean, I bet I haven't been out to dinner in a long, long time. I've been cooking at home almost every single night. And I've got out of the house a little bit to go check on our dealerships and to go up in the mountains of North Carolina a little bit. But other than that, I've pretty well been buckled down. We've got ourselves big time into motorcycle building right now. So I've been messing with that with my kid, Steven, and watching the guys do that. But, you know, my job with the Motor Racing Network is kind of not going on right now because of no racing. But hopefully we'll get back pretty soon to Darlington on the 17th and we'll have some stuff going on there again. But I've been keeping busy. I've really been enjoying myself and seeing a different side of life. I really have. I got more time in my hand now, just like most people do. And I never thought I'd have this much time, but I'm enjoying life right now. I really am.
Rusty, racing has been a part of your life. I mean, most of your life. So all of a sudden you hit the brakes like this. You said you're learning how to cook and cooking up a storm. What else do you like to do?
Well, I mean, I'm a big golfer. I'm not great at golfing, but fortunately some of our courses up in the North Carolina mountains are open for limited play. And I've been up there doing that a little bit. And I've, how much I love going down to Mexico. I love going down there, but that's even closed. So I can't get down there. So really my big deal is to come up and watch these guys with the bikes and doing the cooking and hanging out and just, and oh my gosh, I cannot believe how much stuff Patty and I have done at home, far as cleaning out closets, reorganizing. And I guess everybody else is doing the same thing, because when I go by the Home Depot and the Lowe's and all that, everybody's buying things. And I think one big problem that's going on right now, all the donation centers that we want to donate all our clothes and things we're clearing out are closed. So I've been taking all that stuff over to the storage unit, letting it pile up and doing that. But, you know, honestly, I'm just making do with what we got to do right now. And honestly, I wake up every morning a little later than I normally have these great breakfast. I come up to work. I have a great time watching these guys up here. I've been real entertained. I haven't slowed down a bit. And we've been really, really fortunate with our businesses. They haven't been affected much by COVID-19. The dealerships are all up in Tennessee. I've been in the business for 29 years now. And Tennessee listed them as essential business. So we haven't slowed up at all. So I've been real blessed. I really have, Jamie. And I've been real, real happy. A lot of people haven't been this fortunate, but I'm not complaining. That's for sure.
Yeah, that's great to hear. And Rusty, I remember you telling me one time that obviously you raced for Roger Penske your entire Cup career, but you said it's really what made Roger special was what he taught you about life outside of racing. And that leads to your dealerships. What kinds of things and what kind of relationship did you guys have?
Well, Roger and I's relationship still is very, very strong. In fact, I was just with him at Amelia Island, Florida. He was honored down there as the 2020 recipient for the Concours d'Elegance. I think that's how you explain it. But I talked to him a lot. Patty and I were down there with him and his wife, Kathy, and myself and Rick Mears. And we had, we had Ray Everham being the host down there for the show. That was big time. But Roger and I talked a lot about car business when I was down there. I just reminiscing about old times. But you know, he's just such a great mentor. He's been getting a lot of accolades lately. And obviously what he's doing up there in Indianapolis with the Speedway and the car dealerships has always been amazing. But for him to get involved in the Speedway now, you got to believe that's his golf game at the moment. He's really, really enjoying that. probably not so much that the Indianapolis is going to be delayed, but still, he has taught me a lot about life on the track and off the track. And you mentioned earlier that, hey, you know, there's going to come a time when you're not going to drive any longer, and you better be planning for that. And he helped me get that started earlier, 29 years ago now. People don't realize that. Been in a car business for 29 years. We've got 8 dealerships up in the Knoxville, Tennessee area. I got a wonderful partner up there. His name is Ray Huffaker. Ray's been like my second father, and we've had a great time together. But that's always been kind of one of my main things. I love that car business. But, you know, there's other things outside of the car business I love, too, besides my family. It's these doggone motorcycles. I've been really loving building these real hot rod Harleys. We're going to be out in Sturgis, South Dakota again this year for a big charity event. We're taking a lot of my buddies out there. Boyer's going to be out there. Clint Boyer's going to be there. Don Perdomo's going to be there. My buddy Walker Evans. Mike Helton will be out there. We're going to have a lot of people. And we're doing the second annual Rusty Wallace charity ride with the Buffalo Chip. And the Buffalo Chip is the biggest biker bar on the planet. So we have a lot of fun with those guys out there. And I was just
that
on the phone.
Like a headache, Rusty. That group you named. Oh, my goodness.
It's not a headache at all. It's a lot of fun, you know. It really is. And, my gosh, even got my wife riding with me now. She sits on the back. And, man, she loves going to Sturgis.
That is awesome. The pictures last year, and I remember the stories from Boyer, how much fun you guys have had. When did you start riding Harleys?
We started riding probably, oh, my God. Mike Helton's the first guy got me going. He took us all to Sturgis many years ago. I think probably almost 15 years ago. And they go and every other year maybe, but I stay hooked on it pretty hard. I'm kind of hooked on the deal and I like it. Then I started building custom Harleys. And then Steven, my son, got involved in building the custom stuff. And now he's become really a master builder at those things. We've sold 5 or 6 really expensive, nice bikes so far to different clients and stuff. But I just got off the phone with Rod Woodruff, who owns the Buffalo Chip, and we're already doing planning for the big rally. It looks like the rally is 100% on out in Sturgis. It hasn't been shut down or nimbled down at all. They haven't had hardly any cases of COVID-19 out there, and it's been under control. So one of the largest motorcycle rallies in the world is on.
That's great. I'd love to hear you mention Steven as well. Obviously, he raced in the Xfinity Series for a while for you, and I remember you celebrating in Victory Lane with him. So I know people want to know, where is he? What's he up to? I know Greg is still working, doing PR and kicking butt in that regard with you. So the kids are all good. They're all grown and on their own now.
Yeah, Greg's doing great. He's sitting right here with me right now while we're doing this interview. He's got 3 children now, and I got 4 grandkids, and I didn't have any grandkids 2 years ago. Now I got 4 of them, and I know they're all doing good though. They're happy. And so Greg is at the shop almost every single day with me. He's taking care of those children. And Steven is here at the shop back building those motorcycles, and he still wants to race. But he really likes those short track cars that run through the Midwest, the old American Speed Association style cars. That's still pretty big down here in the Carolinas, but we haven't done that yet because we pretty well focused on these bikes. That's been like his new passion. Actually, sometimes I think more than racing, because he really enjoys creating things and all the custom paint and all the cool things we're doing. So no, the boys are all looking great. They're fine. I'm keeping busy, plenty busy with Motor Racing Network and the cars, and running around the country doing some speeches. I just did a big speech down Atlanta, Georgia for Porsche the other day. That was a lot of fun. And then when COVID came on, a lot of that stuff got shut down. So I'm quite busy. You know, I do still miss driving a car occasionally when Bristol comes around or when Martinsville comes around and stuff like that. But
how do you think you'd do, Rusty, if you hopped in a car and competed at Bristol next week?
Well, you always think you can do good. I mean, it's all about getting in the car and getting some reps and getting some practice and really seeing how can you do. And I'm going to go back to what I did about 2 years ago. I got called up to go down to Daytona to race a Ferrari for the first time. And I'm like, okay. The Ferrari people have a thing called a Ferrari Mandala. And they brought 124 cars from 3 continents to Daytona to put this gigantic race on. And they said, we'd like to get one of those retired NASCAR guys to race with us. So I got a phone call from the guys at NASCAR, went down there. Long story short, 123 cars entered and I finished 10th, and I was pretty happy with that. And so I said, man, I think I still can do this. But I will tell you, it took me a while to get warmed up and get my rhythm going again. But you know, if I went to Bristol or Martinsville, I'd have to have a couple of days of practice to get the momentum going again. And then I think I could actually be pretty doggone competitive. Could I go out there and dominate like I used to do? I don't know. I guess you just got to go do it to figure out how fast you are.
Yeah.
I talked to some people that say, you know, almost all drivers think they can still do it at any age, but you just lose something when you, you know, are out of the car too long. It just takes a long time to get going back in, but yeah. I would like to do it. You know, I told NASCAR I'd like to drive the brand new 2021 car, and they said, hey, we'd love to have you drive that car. I said, okay, we might give that a whirl.
That would be awesome. Hey, Matt Kenseth's coming back. Rusty, jump in the seat. Let's see it at Bristol.
Hey, right behind me in these cabinets are all my uniforms. So I could grab one out, dust off one of those helmets up there in the back of this shot and give it a whirl, right? I mean, I wouldn't be embarrassed. I'd give it hell and see what happens.
That is awesome. Rusty, when you speak about racing, you could tell you're still so passionate about it. You're so energetic. After all these years, what keeps you in the game? What keeps you loving the sport still?
Well, I think it's personalities. It's the people that I grew up with and things that we do maybe off track. Like I don't know if I mentioned to you earlier or not, but last year, in fact, every single year for the last 5 years, we get invited by Ron Pratt. And Ron Pratt is one of the biggest names in cars. He was the man of us purchasing all these cars out of Bear Jackson every year in January. He invites us all out to his place in Glamis, California, that area, actually an area called Gordon Wells. And he brought this year, he brought me, he brought Jeff Gordon, he brought Mark Martin, he brought, oh my gosh, who else? Greg Biffle, John Perdomo, the list goes on and on. We had like 20 people. And we get out there and we compete. Kyle Busch was with us. I didn't know if he was going to come or not, but Kyle Busch showed up. John Elway, the football player, was with us. But we rode these vehicles out in the desert and really had a lot of great camaraderie. We talked about our sport. And at that particular time, it felt to me that we all became equal. Instead of, hey, you won 20 races, maybe you won 50 races, none of that stuff. We all were kind of on the same level. And we got along really, really good. And so, you know, listening to these guys and out there having fun with them in the desert makes me want to watch them on a weekly basis at the track. And for me, I don't think I could ever get out of NASCAR and feel comfortable. That's one of the main reasons I love radio so much. It keeps me involved in the sport. You and I worked together for a long, long time with ESPN. We had a good time during that venture. But now, if I would have just stopped at the end of television, I'd have probably had a big empty void in me. So I was able to do the radio stuff, and I'm really having a cool time with that. Guys like Winston Kelly been around for a long time, some of the big names in the Motor Racing Network and radio I work with. And so I'm only doing, what is it now? It's about 20 races I think I do total. And it's enough at the track for me.
Yeah. Now, Rusty, going back to when you did get out of the car and you did make the transition to TV, your first year in the broadcast booth wasn't NASCAR. It was IndyCar. Let's go back and relive that year. What was it like for you, Rusty? If you can remember the first time calling a race, I have some funny memories and moments from then. You becoming a broadcaster, having to watch your mouth. And
yeah.
Call your first 500. What do you remember?
Oh my gosh. I remember 06. I know we didn't get the NASCAR contract of 2007. I retired at the end of 2005. So I had all of 2006 with really nothing to do. So when I went to work for ESPN, they said, hey, look, we want to get you accustomed to being a broadcaster. And so we want to bring you into IndyCar. And I went, IndyCar, wow. So I remember right off the bat being so excited because that was something totally different. And I just got done driving for Penske for many years, who was like the indie guy. So I remember I wanted to really understand the car. So I went up to Reading, Pennsylvania, got fitted up an Indy car, went down to Homestead, Florida and watched them practice. And Roger let me drive the Indy car. And I remember we had Elio there. We had Sam Hornish. We had Rick Mears. We had all these guys tutoring me along. And I'm driving this Indy car. And so I got a lot of good feel about the car. And so when I was talking on the broadcast, you know, I could talk about the, you know, the different changes and feel comfortable with that. But then there were some crazy things that went on where I pretty well got excited. And I remember one case at Indianapolis for the Indy 500. I was watching the flyovers and all the stuff going on. I was getting so excited. And it's my time to bring the fans in and talk about the feelings that I'm feeling. I said, you guys will not understand. This is the best feeling I've ever had here at the Daytona 500. I mean, the Indy 500. And so I said, Daytona, said Indy. And oh my gosh, everybody saw that. And they all remembered that. The other time, I guess, had to be at Kansas City, Missouri. We had a race going on there, the IndyCar race. Sam Hornish won the race, and our producer back then, his name is James Shifton, and Shifty comes across the radio and goes, "Hey, Rusty, we're not going to go to Victory Lane. We're live on ABC. We're going to run out of time. You got to interview him from your radio up in the booth, you know? So I'm going to talk from the booth to Hornish as he's winding down from just winning this race." And I go, "Hey, Sam Hornish, Rusty Wallace up here in ABC booth. You got us?" And so what you do there, you got the microphone here, right? Then yeah. You got the button here. So you're pushing this button and you got a microphone. Well, you generally don't push this button. Okay. This is only for talking on the radio to the driver. So anyway, I did it twice. I said, "Hey, Sam, Rusty Wallace with ABC, do you have us?" No, I didn't hear nothing. So I went again. No. So finally I let off the button and I went, "Oh shit." I went, "Oh shit," you know? And I went, and then I went it again because I realized then I when a finger came off the button, I thought my mic was not working, but I forgot that this mic was on. And then I hear Shifty comes across and he goes, "New York, you got an oh shit coming in 5, 4, 3, 2. So I did some stupid stuff like that, you know, but I really think right now that's probably the only cuss word I said and that I got away with. And, but IndyCar was fun. They really treated me really, really good. I had fun time, 2-hour races, competitive races. 06 was good. And then we started NASCAR in 2007. And when did we end with ESPN? I can't remember. What year was that? Was that
2015? 13? Was our last year with ESPN.
15?
Eight years.
Okay. Yeah. So we ran from, I did it for 9 years. I remember that. 9 years. Yeah.
Yeah.
So Rusty, that was a good run.
That 2006 moment with Sam Hornish, you told it exactly how I remembered it. It was so classic, but it was so you. Like, that was just, this was a championship NASCAR winning driver coming over and being a broadcaster. It was so real.
Well, I'll never forget when I let off that button and I went, "Oh," and I went, I said, "No." and then I told Shifty, I said, "Are they going to fire me?" And he goes, and then that's when I heard him say, "New York, you got this coming," you know? So we had, what did we have, a 20-second delay or something, or maybe.
Yeah, when you're on the broadcast, that's what a lot of people ask, you know, do you guys have a delay? So when we're on ESPN, we don't. So it would have come across on the air and we would have had to say sorry for that language. But when you're on the network, there is that delay. So nobody at home knew anything, Rusty.
Yeah, no, it's just between me and you, right?
Yeah, exactly. Oh man, that was such a good chuckle. We had a lot of those over the years, but
yeah, we did.
What was it like, Rusty, though, once 2007 came around and you were a full-time broadcaster and you were looking down at that racetrack with those competitors that you were used to competing against? What was that like?
It was a whole different view, that's for sure, because you could really see things getting ready to happen. When you're driving the car, you know, you're whatever's coming at you, you're reacting to. But when you sit up in the booth and you look down at all the rest of the competitors on the racetrack, you can say, "Hey, wait a minute, this guy just pitted. I see this guy getting loose or getting tight. I hear these guys getting ready to put 4 when these guys are going to get 2. And there's so much more information when you're up in the booth looking down. You can see a situation creating itself and getting ready to happen. And when you're driving the car, you can't. And when you're a crew chief, you can't as much as you do up in that doggone booth looking down, watching this whole thing getting ready to come down. And so for me, it was a whole different world. And for me also, I wanted to be nice to every single driver. And tell you the truth, the TV guys didn't want me to do that. They want me to call it how it is. Tell me what you think, Rusty, you know? So I found myself being critical at times going, "Man, I didn't like that. You know, I didn't like doing that. I didn't like, you know, calling these guys out saying, 'Hey, that was a wrong call. I would have never done that,' blah, blah, blah," you know? So didn't really enjoy that part of it because I was a driver and / crew chief, because you know how involved I was to setting the cars up and just couldn't get out of that part.
You had your team at the time, your Xfinity team.
Yeah, I did.
What was it like for you, Rusty, trying, you know, at ESPN, we did make a great effort for all of us to be in the garage doing our research and making the rounds. What is that like to go into the garage and you're not a competitor of theirs anymore, but you're trying to get information for the broadcast?
It was almost kind of weird. It was actually real weird and it would still be real weird to this day because I would go up and just kind of look around and ask these guys questions. And I remember one of them going, "Tell us what to do. What would you do?" You know, and then I would ask questions and they would say, "Why are you asking this stupid question? You already know the answer to it." I'm going, "Because television wants me to ask the question. They want to say, Rusty talked to Mario and Mario said, which I get that. But I would do IndyCar racing a little bit. I remember going to Indianapolis. I got in a fight with our producers. And I went down, I started talking to Mario, and I was talking to Michael Andretti. And he looked at me right and said, why are you asking me these questions? You already know the answers. I said, it's a long story. It's because I've been told to, you know. So that was ups and downs in the sports. There was a good stuff and bad stuff. But when you were a competitor and you were so used to setting those cars up and doing all the mechanical work yourself and you knew most of these answers, it was tough, you know, having to go down there and ask them. But I did get a lot of good information when I went to the garage area and would talk to them and be entertained. Now, I will tell you, in radio, you know, talking to everybody in the garage area, it's really, really hard to use any of that during the broadcast because we were just calling the race as it happens. We don't have time to do any storytelling. Or, hey, this week I heard that Jeff went and did this or Joe went and did that. We don't do any of that. Now, we did that with ESPN, and I'm sure you do that with Fox and all your pre-race stuff and all that. But for radio, there's not a lot of times you can use that. Now, you got to be knowledgeable of what's going on. And I stay very, very involved in the sport. And I mentioned to you a little while ago, I want to drive the new NASCAR 2021 car. So I got more knowledge about that car because that's something totally different. Rear transaxle, that's going to come out, you know, the big wheels with one lug nut, all that type of stuff. So I really want to immerse myself in all that and understand it all. But it was fair, back to your original question, it was fairly uncomfortable, you know, sticking your head under the hood, because I had a lot of hoods slammed because he's still tied with Penske. I'll guarantee if he finds something trick in our car, he's going to run back and tell Penske, which I never did. I never did do any of that, but I can understand how the competitors would think since I was so embedded with that two car team and the Penske team for so long that it'd be hard for me to turn that off. But I actually really did. I did like knowing some of this stuff was going on. And knowing that the Penske guys didn't have that and like, man, I wish I could go over there and tell them all this stuff if I wanted to help them, but I kept my mouth shut. I was respectful to that.
Yeah. Rusty, you still have such a fan following and it's because of your personality. You're feisty. You were a winner, such a hard-nosed competitor. Going back over the years of racing, 25 years in Cup, what are some of the battles, maybe rivalries that stand out to you still to this day?
Well, you know, it seems like almost every single story I tell about rivals and battles always include Dale Earnhardt Sr. all the time. One of the guys I raced with a ton that I really, really respected, and I really respected him so much because of what he knew about the car was Mark Martin. Mark really understood his car a lot, and we grew up together on the American Speed Association back in the 80s and the late 70s. I mean, some of those battles that Mark and I had at the racetracks on those short tracks were epic. They were great. Some of those battles that I had with Earnhardt at Bristol, Tennessee, I'll forget one at Michigan where I led the race all day long at Michigan, 12 laps to go. I ran out of fuel. I start to hit pit road. Caution flag comes out. I come down pit road. They got the gas cans trying to get the thing fired back up. I get back on the track, we restart in 12th position. Now I'm mad because I've been leading all day long and I passed a car every single lap and going into turn three with the checkered flag wave and I caught Earnhardt, passed him and won the race. Those are pretty cool battles. Remember going to Bristol, him and I raced so hard lap after lap after lap. He won the race, I finished second. He pulls up in the victory lane. He was so wore out and tired that he could not lift his hand to turn the engine off in victory lane. His crews had to come down and turn the engine off. I got out of my car at the base of victory lane, slipped down the door and landed on the asphalt, so dizzy and passed out with heat exhaustion, I couldn't even move. We that night drove each other right to almost passing out. It was one of the hardest races I ever raced in my life. But, you know, I found myself always judging myself off of him. Even if I go to the racetrack and I qualify really bad, maybe I qualify like 30th. If I look at the sheet after qualifying, he was 32nd. My 30th qualifying run didn't bother me a bit. You know, I knew because he was back there with me. Now, if he had been up front and I qualified terrible, I would have felt like crap because I always considered him to be the best. And when we lost him, man, it just felt weird. I went to the racetrack every single week for a long, long time going, man, whatever. These other drivers just don't do nothing for me, man. It's just, I don't feel like I'm racing the best any longer. I feel like I'm just racing a bunch of dudes. And that's what it felt like.
Wow. What was your relationship with Dale Sr. off the track, Rusty?
We did a lot of vacationing. We were in the Bahamas a lot on boats. We went down there. He taught my, I took the kids out to his farm one time to learn how to shoot a gun. We did that. He was just real kind off the track. And when you got on the track, you're like, man, what just happened here? This guy just turned from Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde to totally different personality. But boy, as soon as that race was over and we were back to normal life, he loved hanging out in that farm. But I spent most of my time just talking to him about cars and a couple times out of his farm. But most of the time, we spent a lot of time down in those doggone Bahamas hanging out in those boats. And our wives are good friends. They were good friends and haven't seen each other in a long time. But yeah, he was just, we always got along good. You know, he was, I remember one of my dealerships up in Tennessee. I called him up one time and I said, hey, I want you to come up to my store for an autograph session. He said, man, no problem. I'll come up to your store if you come to mine. So he had a Chevrolet store and I went to his place and he went to mine. He didn't charge me and I didn't charge him. And we had a great bunch of people. We had probably 3,000 people show up. We did stuff like that.
I love that. I could reminisce for so long, but unfortunately we only have so much time.
I understand.
You talked about the competitors, Rusty. And when you look at the field now in NASCAR, are there any drivers that you're a fan of that you look to like, man, he's got it. And this guy, he's fiery and somebody that you really keep your eye on.
I'm a fan of all drivers, but I'm really a fan of drivers that know what they're talking about. I'm really a fan of drivers that understand their car. And Kevin Harvick and Keselowski really come to mind, and Kyle Busch. Let's start with Harvick. Harvick owned his own race team. He designed his own cars. He's won with his own cars, whether it's a truck series, the Xfinity series. Grew up in Bakersfield, California, building his own cars. He wasn't one of these guys that came on and just got in a car and drove the car for somebody. He actually designed and built and understood every component of the car. Mark Martin did the same thing as Kevin Harvick did. And so did Brad Keselowski. Him and his father up there in Michigan, no money in their pocket, just working grease from head to toe every single night, building those shocks and building those cars and painting those cars and towing to the racetracks and understanding everything about it. And Kyle Busch has got that gift also. I mean, Kyle's got his own teams right now that are winning. It seems like every time he gets in his own Joe Gibbs a cup car, he's winning. He understands the setups. He understands all the stuff. In fact, I even saw a totally different side of him when I was out in the sand dunes at Glamis. He shows up with all his rigs, his sand cars, had a couple of pit crew guys. I said, man, this guy's taking it serious. We're here just to have some fun. He's got all this stuff. He knew about all of it, all the engine stuff, everything. So that type of driver is who I pull for and really like. Some of the drivers that if I sense they don't respect this sport as much as I respect it, and they don't have that upbringing like Harvick and the guys I just mentioned, I personally just don't have as much respect for them as I do for the other ones.
So it's probably strange for you in this new generation where crew chiefs, they don't want their drivers to know all that stuff. They want them to be a driver and a driver only. Is that strange for you to talk to those guys who really don't understand the mechanics of a race car?
It's totally strange for me to talk to them like that, because you could talk to them and I say, bless their hearts. They can't know because the team won't tell them. The team keeps everything so quiet. Some of them do, some of them don't. And a lot of drivers just don't want to understand it. I mean, I remember talking to Jeff Burton. He said, Rusty, you cannot believe how tough this stuff is getting. And it's got me so confused. I'm completely getting out of it. Just let those crew guys do it. I said, oh boy, this is going to be a mistake. And boy, as soon as he did that, he ran worse. And I said, you needed to keep your butt under the hood of that car. And Jeff Gordon, you can talk to Jeff. He worked with you. Him and I disagree on this all the time. He tells me, he said, if you'd have stayed away from the car, I think you'd have run better. And I told him, I said, if you would have stayed involved in that car later in your career, you'd have run better. Yeah, so we disagree on that. I was brought up trying to understand the car because I don't want to put everything, when the car is not happy and it's not handling good, I don't want to put all these problems in somebody else's lap. I don't want to blow it off on somebody else. Man, it gets down in the dirt. You got to figure this stuff out. And I can't drive without not understanding it. So with that said, that's the reason I'm passionate about these drivers that understand these cars. The ones that just show up with that helmet in their hand and just drive the car, whatever, man. You know, I'm not big on that.
Do I dare ask you what your opinion of iRacing is?
Every single time I've ever drove a simulator, I crashed it. If I turn it left, I can't get it to do nothing. Now, I'd love to drive one of these new simulators. I really would, to see if they react like the real car. And so then all I can do is just listen to the guys who drive them. And I remember Kyle got in it the first time, and he wasn't real fond of the way it felt. It just didn't have the feel like a real car. And how can it? You know, I mean, you're not slipping and sliding all over the track. The guys, when I listen to them in a broadcast, it sounds like they are. So what I need to do is keep my mouth shut right now. I just need to get in one of those simulators and drive it and see what it really does feel like. Because I honestly don't know what I'm talking about, but I will tell you, I tune into the Fox broadcast every single week like it's religion, because to me, it's like, hey, it's race time. It starts at 1 o'clock here in the East Coast. I'm going to turn it on to see what it does. And I do like watching the personalities. I do like watching what Jeff's got to say. I do like watching what Regan does when he goes to these different houses and talks to these guys. So yeah, I do enjoy that, doing that.
Interesting. Awesome, Rusty. Well, I hope that we can talk face-to-face at the track soon. We're excited that things are going to get underway, so we don't have to talk about iRacing every week. We could talk about the real thing.
Well, the iRacing has been really good for NASCAR. It's been really good for the young generation. I mean, I remember when Steven was young and Greg, those kids were playing with those video games all the time, and they were quite good at it. So there's a lot of young and upcoming drivers that want to get involved in sports somehow, so that was a pretty good way. And so we hope you guys don't have to do it too much longer, that we get back to real racing, and it looks like that's just right around the corner.
That's right. Hey, Rusty, real quick, I always tell, you know, people always want to know, how do I get to the next level of broadcasting? How do I get to that job that I want? And I always go back to a story, something that you told me, Rusty. It was the end of our IndyCar run in 2006. And you said, hey, are you coming over to NASCAR? Are you going to do the broadcast with us? And I said, Rusty, I want to. That's my goal. But everybody is beating down our boss's door right now. They want that job. I don't want to be another one of those just saying it. And you said, Jamie, let me tell you something. The squeaky wheel gets the grease. You need to tell him. And I did, Rusty, and I got the job.
Well, good. I'm glad you squeaked a little bit, because I tell you, a lot of people in life complain, I don't get this, I don't get that. I said, did you ask them? Well, no, I just thought that maybe I get a call. I said, you don't get nothing unless you ask for it. And a lot of times that's not good enough either. But, you know, I've learned that the squeaky wheel gets the grease. If I don't feel comfortable about something, I'm going to bring it up and talk about it. It's worked good for me. So, and it worked good for you, didn't it? That's good.
It worked for me, Rusty. So thank you for the advice, and thank you for your time today. It's always fun to reminisce with you.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. We can go on and on and talk about it all, but I'm looking forward to getting back to the track and seeing how it turns out this year.
Awesome.